Yeah, this is Tool Shed Art Club. Guess who's back? Back again.
Did you text your dad about those signs?
What do you mean?
I texted you and I was like, hey, can you tell your dad I dropped those signs off?
No, I don't get text messages. I didn't.
Dude,
even say
I put
it.
A copy of my book with the signs and it rained the next day, dude.
they got it because I went over to my parents' house and my mom, she asked, she was like, did you know that Matt wrote a book? And I'm like, yes, I knew that. And then she showed me that you wrote something really nice in the cover. So if she has that, then they have to have the signs.
I was more worried about it raining the next day and then the book getting damaged and then your dad not seeing the note I left for him.
Yeah.
So that's good. Well, I was saying that we should tell people that we've been busy doing artistic things. So I figured we could give a rundown of some of the projects we've been up to.
Yeah, you start, because I don't even know where to begin.
Yeah, so I have spent, well, really, I would say our hiatus is on me, because I've been saying, let's wait, because I've been spending all the free time that I get, basically working on it full time, working on a book, which is supposed to come out sometime, hopefully, in the next 30 days. Basically was the not-so-secret ghostwriter for my martial arts instructor, James Rosenbach. It's his autobiography, his life story. And I had spent all the time doing interviews with him, transcribing his notes. He had been painstakingly writing this for like 10 years, like by hand. So I was, you know, putting that into a computer, basically trying to fill in the gaps with interviews, doing tons of research, interviewing other people, really writing in a real book. I felt like my fictional book was easy to write because you're just writing down and just imagining things. And then my political book I wrote was kind of easy because I had written it down in pieces over the years. But this one was a serious project. And the goal is to have it out by the end of the year, to have it out by December specifically. And so been tied up doing that.
It's about karate.
Yeah. Yeah,
my favorite thing.
It's gonna be a lot of it, and I did break away to make these leather flip flops too. By the way, so
yeah, those are pretty sweet.
Got into leather making, and that. But you know, we'll talk about some of the stuff we want to do next. But you know, the other thing is too is that so we had released Seeker Driven at the beginning of the year, and to be a little bit vague, we were in some communication of potentially doing something bigger with it, which was the entire goal. You know, we have a movie script for that we want to release. And we can also roll with it as a TV show as well. And so we had some, you know, momentum there. And just one of those things that takes time. And, you know, hopefully that's still on the table. But, you know, we're not holding our breath on it. We're going to keep rolling with the punches. So that took up a little bit of time as well. Now you go.
I mean, I don't even, I've been just, what, I don't, dude, so much has happened.
You had all those video projects. What was the band that did you go to Chicago for that shoot?
I went to Kansas City. Yeah. Lopan Banks. Check them out. I'll probably put a video right here. All in this, gosh, I'll rip this, break this, make this shit outrageous. Don't make this, don't make faces, don't not turn this up in your basement. Co-rock the jam with the quickness, so you can rock this in your tape deck up in this. Dope all along, poke to the dawn, I choke your right rope with the rope polygon. This beat's for making, this set's for taking. MCs don't even see me, it's breaking. Yeah, you like that?
That was a huge one too.
That's it. Yeah, it was ongoing. I mean, it was in filmed the concert in, I mean, I'm going to say like July, and I'm still cutting reels out of it, but Yeah, a lot of tons and tons of video editing, and I mean, it's been busy.
To be a little bit vague, I mean, I think you did do a video project for your mom's church too, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah. That, so. Editing stuff for other comedians. Yeah, all sorts of projects.
I've been doing a little bit of video editing, just a little. Actually, that reminds me that I do need to ask you about something in Adobe when we leave here. I need to edit the sound on something that I'm trying to put together here.
You got to take, you got to, I mean, I edit everything in Audition.
Isn't that?
Like, for Audition is the audio software for Adobe. But, I mean, you can do stuff in Premiere. And now, like, with the latest updates, they actually have a lot more options for enhancing the audio, you know, quality and clarity and stuff like that. But I just worked in radio production for a while, so I just got used to Audition and can usually bang it out. But, yeah, I'll take a look at it.
That reminds me that Toolshed Art Club may be producing a podcast for somebody else with some degree of notoriety, and I probably won't say anything else than that for
do
now.
Do I know about this?
Yeah.
I do?
Yeah.
Huh.
I sent you the intro for it, and I asked you if you liked it for that guy. I got to keep it vague for now because he is a public figure.
Oh, okay.
An infamous public figure, one might say.
An infinite? All right, I'll cut it out. Tell me, because I honestly cannot.
The
Jesus is a friend of mine. I have a friend in Jesus. Jesus is a friend of mine.
Jesus is a friend of mine.
Jesus is a friend of mine.
One of the other things, too, is I'm sure that people would like to know, you know, if and when we'll have David Gunn on again. And I'll say this, I mean, he's been touring, it seems like, all year. When he's on tour, I don't really text him or try to reach out to him. Like, we'll text, like, I'll send him something funny in our group chat here or there, text him that I think Kid Rock is in the CIA. But we haven't really, like, seriously talked to him about coming back on in a minute. But I figure that we'll probably release a couple and then see where he's at. But like I said, when he's on tour, I basically don't even try. So, you know, hopefully he does. And he's been doing these Discord chats that I've been dying to get on, but when he does it, it's the same time as our church. And so I haven't been able to hop on, but.
Oh, yeah. What does he do with the Discord?
He just, people ask him questions and he answers them. And I want to hop in there and tease him a little bit and ask him when he's going to come on our show. I haven't been able to yet. So I think that we'll have him back on, like I said. But I know that there's probably a substantial amount of people who listen to us who found us through David Gunn. So, you know, there's that. So you wanted me to talk about my wedding, though?
Well, yeah, because it's insane.
So a couple years ago, I wanted to write a fictional book that takes place in prison. And so what I did was I reached out to a prisoner in each facility in Nebraska. I went and met with one. And I wanted to reach out to somebody who was on death row. Now, everybody who's on death row in Nebraska has obviously committed some pretty heinous crimes. And there wasn't really anybody there that I felt very comfortable either, you know, just was disgusted by what they had done, so I didn't want to talk to them, or I thought that they would be too insane to talk to. And I'm just trying to find somebody reasonable on death row is not an easy task. Well, one of the people on there is...
of course it wouldn't be an easy task.
So one of the people I found on there was John Lauder. His case is that they made the movie Boys Don't Cry about it. He was one of the guys arrested and indicted for killing Brendan Tina.
Brandon Tina's complicated life inspired the Golden Globe-winning film Boys Don't Cry.
I didn't know anything about him. I know a guy that shared a cell with the other guy who was implicated on that killing. And so I thought, well, this is probably just like a guy who is an isolated part of Nebraska. You know, probably hates gay people or something, and, you know, met one and went crazy and killed him. Wasn't sure what to expect, but out of everybody, I thought, well, maybe, you know, it's 2024. I'm sure times are different now. Maybe he's, you know, maybe he's different. So I reached out to him, and what I had found in this was it wasn't at all what I had expected. He seemed to me to be, genuinely pretty liberal, which is funny. And he has his side of the story, is interesting. And, there's a documentary, you can watch it on Tubi. If you just look up the Brendan Tina story, I believe is what it's called. But when I watched that documentary, what I took away from it was that, the other guy that was arrested, they tried him first. They gave him the death penalty. When it came time for John Lauder's sentence, it didn't appear that they had enough evidence to convict him. So they went back to the first guy, said, if you change your story, we'll take you off death row. So he comes back around, says, I didn't do anything. It was all John. They take him off death row. They put John Lauder on death row. John has always maintained that he's innocent.
Tom Neeson and John Lauder were arrested and charged with the murders. They were tried separately in 1995. Both were facing the electric chair. But after his conviction, Neeson cut a deal, turned on Lauder, and testified against him.
What do you think of Marvin Neeson?
He's a little f***ing liar.
Neeson got life in prison.
Defendant John L. Lauder is hereby sentenced to the penalty of death for the murder of Tina Brown.
Lauder sits on death row.
He's always maintained that he wasn't even there when the murders happened. And he's got people who are, you know, trying to fight for him to be free. So, you know, when I first reached out to him, I was just trying to do research on this book I wanted to write. And I was just kind of asking him questions about life in prison and life on death row specifically. I didn't really want to look into the crimes at first because I was like, look, I just need my questions answered. But I decided after kind of watching this documentary, I thought, wow, I didn't realize this at all. And then as I got to know him, I realized like this guy has people in his family who are gay, and this gay couple will come and visit him in prison, and he seems to have no problem with it. One time we were talking on the phone, and he had read me a letter from a trans person who wrote to him, and he said, you know, I'm going to write back and you know, explain, because this person was like, why would you do this? And so he's like, hey, if you want to talk about it, I'll give you my side of the story. It was a lot different than I had expected. So anyway, I get a phone call from John, and he said that he needed to ask me a favor. And I was like, yeah, what's going on? And he said, hey, man, would you officiate my wedding? And I thought, you want me to go get certified and officiate your wedding on death row? And so I said, of course, how could I say no? So I went and got certified, went down to Tecumseh in Nebraska, and I officiated this wedding between him and a gal that he had dated before he was ever arrested or anything like that had happened. And so it was an interesting day. So I go there, go to the prison. They let me in, and his second witness was running behind. And so I go up to the guard and I said, hey, the second witness is running late. I don't know if they'll be here or not. Can we use like a guard for the other witness? And the lady goes, no, I don't think so. And I'm like, okay, well, what are we supposed to do? And she goes, we'll just get someone else from death row. So I'm like, yo. So then...
It was a death row party.
Yeah, so then second witness is running late, and they go up to him, and they're like, you got to pick someone from your unit, from your side of death row. And I know that he has Nico Jenkins on his unit, which anybody who's not from Nebraska, Nico Jenkins is probably the most notorious criminal in Nebraska. Everybody knows his name around here.
This panel finds that the death penalty is appropriate, should be, and is hereby given for each of the four murders by the defendant.
Four death sentences and another 12 convictions, each with 45 to 50 years in prison. That is what the three-panel judge ruled in the Nico Jenkins case.
He ended up choosing somebody else.
I don't know. Could you imagine Nico Jenkins sitting in the corner just staring at you?
Oh, yeah, I could. My understanding is that he has, because he's in prison now and they're giving him the medication or whatever that I needs, I think he's more stable. I mean, before before he killed people, he was telling them, like, hey, if you let me out of this prison, I'm killing people. And they let him out of the prison, and then he killed people. So, you know.
He tried to warn them.
Who could have predicted that? So, so anyway, they bring in another guy and who killed a few people. And he's like, yo, are you the preacher? And
I'm yeah, like, from, yeah. From a bank heist, right, where they got zero money.
Yeah.
Five people are dead, gunned down at about 8:45 this morning at a U.S. bank branch on Highway 81 in Norfolk. We're told the dead are four employees and one customer.
They just walked in and shot everyone without, and then realized there was no one left to give them money.
Yes. Yeah, that's pretty much exactly how it went down. So, met him, and then they're like, oh, the second witness is here. And so then they tell the guy, they're like, you can just sit here. So he just sits there, and I do the wedding, and it went through, and yeah. So people on death row can get married. There's a ton of things that they can't do. They can't. There's certain dental things they can't get. There's certain religious things they can't get. And by the way, I'm a believer of the death penalty. Like, I think pretty much everybody on there should be dead. I don't think that John should be. I think that there's a lot of questions. You know, that I'd still like to see answered with his case specifically, but some of these guys that are on there are on videotape doing their crimes, or they have so much evidence stacked against them. And I'm a believer of the death penalty. Obviously John's not, you know, he wouldn't agree with me on that. We've talked about it before, but
you just said the guy awaiting to be killed is against the death penalty.
Not a big believer of the death penalty, but, obviously, you know, if you're in his situation, of course you wouldn't be. But some of those guys, though, on death row petitioned to be killed.
Like, oh, they wanted to be?
Oh, Aubrey Marcus is petitioning to be killed right now.
Why does he want to be killed?
I don't know.
Because he doesn't want to be in jail?
I got a book here that Henry Rollins recommended to me called Shot in the Heart by Michael Gilmore. And his brother, I think it was in Utah, petitioned to be killed. I don't remember what his brother did. It was maybe a robbery gone bad or something. But his brother wanted to be killed, and may have been the last person to be in that state to be shot in the heart.
Oh, and what state?
I think it was Utah. But
do they just do that from a distance?
It's carried out by a team of five marksmen. They use a match set of 30 caliber Winchester rifles, and the condemned sits in a black metal chair about 25 feet from a wall that has a gun port in it. The rifles are handed out randomly to the team of shooters. And those folks, I should say, are by statute anonymous. And then there's a cadence countdown to a moment when they all fire. The condemned is strapped into a chair. A hood is placed over their head if they choose.
They literally play Russian roulette with a man's heart.
So what they would do is when they would say go, you'd pull the trigger, and then none of them ever know if they actually fired the killing shot.
Oh, it's for the executioners.
Yeah. I told my wife that I think that we should be able to like...
But wouldn't it... Okay.
Like I told my wife that we should be able to like bid on like the next execution and it just be a shooting like that, but you're just the sole trigger person, and she actually got really mad at me for saying that. But I was like, look, dude, I mean, if someone like look at some of the like read about what some of these guys have done, and it's like, okay, he deserves to die. Maybe the state should make a little bit of money off of it. I know that's pretty dark. I'm sure John will be pissed off if he heard me say that. Maybe he'll find out. Sorry, but That's
did you just say you want it to be a lottery?
Yeah, you just bid on who gets. Dude, okay, imagine like when Ted Bundy was killed. Do you know how much money they could have written, like how much money a rich guy would pay?
Yeah, but it would also, I mean, I might be with your wife on this. Wow. Because it would just be disturbing to see how many people would want to kill someone.
I mean, the Bible sanctions it, and so if the state, the Bible sanctions the state sanctioning it. So if the state is sanctioning it, all they need is a trigger man. So.
Right, but then, I mean, just everybody that would be like, yeah, let me in there.
But that's people who want justice done. That's
or just, or people that want a reason, like, to be able to kill someone without any repercussions.
Hey, we can't read everybody's mind or heart, am I right, guys?
We just want their money!
So that was my idea on that. But Yeah, it was. It's pretty bananas. It's always crazy going into a prison, and then especially when you're in the visitation area and you're looking around and you wonder, like, some of the people you may recognize, some of the people you wonder what they're in there for. Prison. That's why I want to write a book on prison, because to me it's the most fascinating. It's one of the most fascinating things with human behavior. Everything's on the line. If I give you a Snickers bar, it's not really me giving you something. There's a meaning behind it, you know, and you have to basically constantly be on edge. So to me, prison is absolutely fascinating. So
what would the Snicker bar, what could that?
It means you owe me something. Oh. So if I give you a candy bar and then I say, hey, I need you to smuggle something or do something, or
I need you to keister this.
Keister something for me. I'm going to need you to keister it. So, you know, that's it's rules to the game. So, yeah, I did that. That didn't really take a whole lot of time, to be honest. You can get certified to do a wedding in literally 30 seconds.
Yeah, yeah.
So
I've been certified.
Now, one of the things, though, I did want to talk about was going into going back into filmmaking mode, and I thought, well, we might as well just have this conversation on camera, because I was talking to you about a little bit earlier today.
Do you want to talk about how you've never seen Planes, Trains, and Automobiles?
This is my nightmare.
Yeah. Dude, I mean, I understand, like, not seeing a lot of movies, but I mean, that one is just synonymous. It's like Christmas Vacation. It's what Christmas Vacation is to Christmas, is Planes, Trains, and Automobiles is to Thanksgiving.
Yeah, so here's the deal. I always wanted to do acting, but in my thought process, I didn't really think that there would ever be a chance to do it locally, but there was always a chance to do music, so I always did music. Now, when I was doing music, I was really doing music. I knew all the bands, I knew all the music. If you mentioned a band, I probably had heard of them, or I knew a fact about them. So I loved movies, but I didn't have the same mindset that I have now, which is that you have to be a student of whatever art you want to do. So now that once I started to figure out how to do acting stuff in Nebraska, then I wanted to become a student of that art. And so now one of my least favorite things is for someone to bring up a movie that I haven't seen. and then when they do the, you haven't seen that?
Yeah.
Which
I don't
is
know,
what I've been living in the last 4 days.
Like, John Hughes is, like, right now you're on a kick where you're watching every single Matthew McConaughey movie, including the animated films. All right. Like, so the fact that, Kubo, I mean, John,
strings. Two strings.
John Hughes is one of the most prolific, celebrated film, you know, screenplay writers and film directors of all time. And the fact that you haven't went down a path of watching every single movie that he has written and or directed is mind blowing to me.
Yeah. I almost went basically six. This is a little bit of an exaggeration, but it's not much. I basically went 6 months without watching any movie. I mean, maybe one movie
a
month.
It's good to take a break.
Or one every 2 months. Whereas before, I was watching like 30 a month. You know what I mean? So since I got the book done and we're kind of in this final editing process, the last few days I watched The Godfather, Wonderland, Easy Rider, Rumblefish. Tonight. I was thinking about, I'm probably not going to get to it, would like to watch The Outfit from the 70s, and then The Night of the Hunter is one that I would like to watch.
What is The Night of the Hunter?
I think it's like a...
It sounds like something William Dafoe would be in.
Let me pull that up. No, Night of the Hunter is from the 50s.
William Dafoe might have been alive in the 50s.
Dude, if we talk about
them... He kind of looks immortal.
True. It's a noir thriller. Reverend Harry Powell is a religious fanatic and a serial killer who targets women who use their sexuality to attract men. Serving time in prison for car theft, he meets condemned murderer Ben Harper, who confesses to hiding $10,000 in stolen loot. Released from jail, Powell is obsessed with finding the money, and he tracks down Harper's widow and her two children.
So he's doing the world a favor.
Well,
killing them whores.
I was a little worried where you're going with that. So So yeah, I'd like to watch that one tonight. Dude, I was going to say though, with Wonderland, what's his name? Is it Josh Lucas? Is that his name? Is that who's in that movie?
You're talking Val Kilmer.
Well, yeah, Val Kilmer's in it, but
I don't know. I saw that movie when it came out.
Josh Lucas.
What year did it come out?
I think it was 2003.
Okay, yeah.
Dude, Josh Lucas's character, I'd love to play a character like that. Dude, just smoking crack and screaming. Like, I love it. Like, when I'm watching a movie and a dude is like...
Would you be a method actor, though? Would you just actually smoke meth and scream?
Yeah, dude. Yeah, Josh Lucas, he plays the one guy that was murdered, got his head beat in. Which, by the way, if we talk about this movie, my mom's going to watch it. I don't know. I don't want my mom to watch a John Holmes movie about John Holmes. I was telling you yesterday, though, I never cared about the Wonderland murders because it just seemed to be drug dealers killing other drug dealers. But... Dude, when Josh is like smoking crack or he's like doing coke and he's like, I need smack, and he's like screaming at people in the room. I would love to play that role. Just screaming and threatening everybody in the room.
Demanding more crack.
Oh dude, that's why that Nicolas Cage movie Bad Lieutenant is like my favorite Nicolas Cage movie, when he's just like screaming in every scene and making everybody uncomfortable.
That's every Nicolas Cage movie.
Oh, but you've seen Bad Lieutenant, right? It's on another level.
I don't know if I have, to be honest. So you can do what? You haven't seen that movie?
Yeah, he's like,
there's too many Nicolas Cage movies.
So fun, like,
even
putting a gun to a dude's head and he's like, it's on till the break of dawn. And then there's one scene where he's like walking in, he's like, what's up? Like,
Nick Cage is wild, man. My favorite is that video of him where he comes out on that talk show and he's just like, yeah.
Why was that happening? I don't know. Was that for Rumblefish or was that after Rumblefish, I wonder?
I don't know. I don't even know. I mean, that was Rumblefish in the 80s?
83.
Yeah, so I mean, it had to be around that time because it was when he had, you know,
by the
his
way,
hair was long and he was just...
Yeah.
But nothing is greater than... Nothing is greater. My favorite Nick Cage movie might be Con Air.
Understandable.
Which is doing a disservice to so many awesome movies he's made.
And that's the one where he says you're Rocket Man, right?
Yeah. And like, but then there's like The Rock.
Yeah.
Which is incredible. But there's something like Con Air is just so... I don't know. And he's like... You better give that girl back her bunny. just that year when he gets out of jail and he's like, oh.
Oh, yeah. One of the most iconic gifts.
Yeah, and he has, I don't know, like he goes to prison because he was trained and they say his hands were a lethal weapon.
Cameron Poe, you have pleaded guilty to manslaughter in the first degree. With your military skills, you are a deadly weapon and are not subject to the same laws as other people that are provoked because you can respond with deadly force.
Then Brad Pitt has the greatest line ever in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood Bruce Lee is like, my hands are registered as lethal weapons.
My hands are registered as lethal weapons. That means we get into a fight, I accidentally kill you, I go to jail.
Anybody accidentally kills anybody in a fight, they go to jail. It's called manslaughter.
Sometimes I just watch that clip.
Which one? Of the Brad Pitt and Bruce Lee?
Yeah.
Oh, that's totally understandable.
So good.
Yeah. But I was going to say, have you seen Easy Rider? Or Rumblefish?
Yeah. I mean, I saw, like, in film school, I saw Easy Rider.
Dude.
And I don't even, like, I didn't even really like it, to be honest.
Okay, neither did I, but
I was just like... Okay.
Easy Rider is a 1969 American independent road drama film written by Peter Fonda, Dennis Hopper, and Terry Southern, produced by Fonda, and directed by Hopper. Fonda and Hopper played two bikers who travel through the American Southwest and South carrying the proceeds from a cocaine deal. The success of Easy Rider helped spark the new Hollywood era of filmmaking during the early 1970s. A landmark counterculture film, and a touchstone for a generation that captured the national imagination, Easy Rider explores the societal landscape, issues, and tensions in the United States during the 1960s, such as the rise of the hippie movement, drug use, and communal lifestyle.
If something was big in its time and it was new for its time, it's ridiculous to look back and be like, well, that sucks. And it's like, well, yeah, looking at it through the lens of now, I'm sure in the, what did that come out in like 69, early 70s? I'm sure, yeah, at that time it was, you know, they felt as if, okay, for instance, the marijuana, when they smoke marijuana in it, it's a more realistic of what it's like to smoke marijuana. Somebody had said that, you know, movies before that were like kind of ridiculous, like they'd smoke it and go crazy or whatever, whereas there it was maybe more realistic.
Real drugs were used in scenes showing the use of marijuana and other substances. Easy Rider was released by Columbia Pictures on July 14, 1969, grossing $60 million worldwide from a filming budget of no more than $400,000. Critics have praised the performances, directing, writing, soundtrack, visuals, and atmosphere. The film was added to the Library of Congress National Film Registry in 1998.
Whatever, I'm sure that a lot of people did watch it and relate and think like, hell yeah, brother, that's what I do. But watching it in 2024, I mean, look, it's cool to see him on the bikes, but didn't really think it was that great. Rumblefish, everybody always talks about how great that was, so I had really high expectations going into it. And obviously, Mickey Rourke was cool.
Mickey Rourke is cool.
And I didn't expect him to have short hair in that movie.
I just love Mickey Rourke's, like, if you listen to him talk about, like, what went wrong in Hollywood, he basically just got in feuds and fights with everyone.
Yeah.
And just hated the system.
Well, I had my career going about 10 years ago, you know.
You let it go, right?
In the right direction. Yeah. I started not liking the business and not liking myself, and I was slowly self-destructing at a pretty fast rate.
And then was like, I'm going to go fight people in Florida now.
I'd gone down to Florida just to hang out, and I was sparring in the old gym, the old Fifth Street gym. It's not there anymore. And some promoter there who knew me from the old days asked me, I was sparring with some kid from Philadelphia. And he said, you still got a couple fights left in it. It ended up, he put up the money for a fight, the War Memorial thing in Fort Lauderdale.
Yeah, he seemed
but
like
he started off as a boxer.
Yeah, he seems like somebody I would gravitate towards.
And like, I, you know, even though his face has become horribly disfigured, it's still like, it's still a cool look.
Yeah.
Like Val Kilmer. Yeah. I think Wonderland was probably one of Val Kilmer's last movies before he got diagnosed and then refused to get treatment because Christian Science was going to heal him. And now he, you know, talks.
Do your impression of his book? Do your impression of what that book's like?
What, his book?
Yeah, how would you describe his book?
I would describe, if I could describe his book in one word, I would describe it as love. love. Everything is about how he loves everyone and everything, and he is like a beacon of love.
Yeah.
Which if you like listen to other people about him, like, dude, I don't know if you realize this, but the actress that's in Wonderland,
the one who plays his girlfriend,
the one, maybe it's Phoebe from Friends.
Yeah, okay, yeah, yeah.
Like, so she plays the older version, right?
No, she plays his wife.
Oh, yeah, his wife. Okay, so she, when that movie came out, like, did an interview saying that Val Kilmer's method of acting is disgusting and, like, disturbed her to her soul.
Well, he was playing John Holmes, so I'm sure that he
Yeah,
was...
but, like, you know, it, like, his method of, like, being that person. Instead of just
saying,
like, roll and then go into it. Because we all know, like, Val Kilmer, when he played Jim Morrison, you know, he wore leather pants for, like, a year straight and was hanging out at Jim Morrison's old bar haunts and
yeah, and people said that, like, people who saw him thought he was Jim Morrison.
I can't even, I associate, like, if I see a picture of Val Kilmer from that movie and Jim, like, to me, they're the exact same person.
Yeah. Yeah, I've been, even doing, I did a movie this year too, by the way. Totally forgot about that. I played a pastor in a movie.
I think you played a boxer.
No, that was a short film. And I think that was technically last year, but, and did an actual, like, a feature film. But anyway, and not like a very big character in it, but had some dialogue lines or whatever. But, I've been on sets where people have to, like, get in a character, and it's, I find it to be so annoying. Like,
what do they do? Well, give me an example of, you watching someone get into character.
Talking to themselves, hyping themselves up. When I don't know if you recall when we were shooting a sketch where somebody was kept walking around and like hyping themselves up for what he was about to play, but that kind of stuff annoys me.
What sketch were we filming where that happened?
When we were in Dallas. It wasn't anything like big.
Who was it?
I don't know the dude's name, but there was one person who kept like walking around and being like, "Yeah, I'm about to do it." And it's like,
"Oh, really? I missed that."
Yeah, but like
probably because I was just having fun.
Yeah, as you should for a comedy sketch. Dude, I don't think you need to like work yourself up for that.
I get it, like if you're new at like a particular craft,
yeah,
and you're in the beginning stages. Like when I started doing stand up, like. To get hyped up and energy and motivated, like I would sit outside the comedy store and blare like Black Betty, you know, like, ooh, Black Betty, ba bam, ba bam, ba bam. And then also blare, even though I didn't do cocaine, the Buck Cherry.
I love the cocaine.
I love the cocaine because it just drives so hard. So
remember when we were supposed to do that interview?
Yeah. Yeah.
Keep rolling, keep going.
Yeah, and like that, I mean, those are the two big ones. I mean, obviously there were others, but I would jam out to that, and then I'd be like, all right. But now, like, I don't have to, like, I've been doing stand-up so long, or if we're doing a sketch or something, like, I don't have to amp myself up.
Yeah.
I just, like, I could literally just show up 30 seconds before I go on stage.
Which I've pretty much seen you do.
Yeah.
Which you just described all of your shows.
I know. Everybody's like,
is that guy like, going to be
here? Anytime I'm like at the Funny Bone or if I'm just doing, because it's my home club, so if I host or I feature, you know, like the headliner or the feature will be like, where's the host? Where's the feature? And they're like,
He's borrowing a truck from his neighbor. Don't worry, he'll be here.
He'll be here right before it starts. And then I just walk in and go on because I just know what to do. So I don't know.
He's running down his acreage a quarter mile away to find somebody can give him a vehicle.
I can't even. Yeah, I live out in the middle of nowhere, like an hour from the Funny Bone. And it's time to go. And I left my car keys in my wife's truck. And realize like, oh man, I have no way of getting there because my other set of keys were locked inside the car. They'd been there for a while, and I'm like, I am not gonna make it. Like, no one can. I couldn't call you and be like, come pick me up, because it's too far out of the way. Like, and I, you know, was gonna leave at the exact time it took me to get there.
You called me and we're like, can you pick up Dave and Matt?
Yeah, I'm like, go pick up Dave and Matt. I'm like sweating, dude. I'm like jabbing screwdrivers into my vehicle and trying to pry open the door and do the whole Jimmy thing. And it's just, it's not working. And so then, yeah, I had to go to this dude, Gary, that lives in my town, who's 70. And I'm like, Gary, I need a huge favor. I need to borrow your vehicle. And he's like, what? And I'm like, listen, I go, you can't, this is showtime. Like, there's no like coming in 5 minutes late. Like, I have to get there. And he was totally cool with
it.
But I always
help.
We got like a mutual thing. Like, he needs help with things like his phone all the time.
Hell yeah.
And
how do I open up my phone?
Yeah, he's like, I don't know, these settings help me out. And I go over there and give him a hand. And
dude, the funniest part for me was like from my perspective, because I had went and met with Dave earlier that day, and I was like, well, I'm just going to stay in Omaha. So I was at that movie Long Legs, which is that Nicolas Cage movie where he's playing a serial killer. And you call me, and I ignore it because I'm at the theater, and then you call me immediately again, and I thought, oh, this is serious. So I'm like trying to like hurry up and like, and I think I even missed your second phone call because I wasn't out of the theater yet.
Yeah.
And then you call me like a third time, and I'm like out of breath because I'm like trying to run out.
You're like, what is it? And I'm like, I have AIDS.
Can you pick them up? And I'm like, yeah, that's fine. No, that's hilarious. But I've also been on, a couple sets where like somebody has to play a bad guy. And if you're around somebody who has to play a bad guy and they have to get in character, that's painful because then they're just being a dick and they're being really obnoxious on set over and over again to try to get themselves, I guess, into the right mind frame. And I've also
I couldn't do it. It would be insufferable to be a director of a film where someone or anyone that is, has an equally big part.
Tell the RoboCop story.
oh yes. Yeah, so, God, I can't. Oh, I want to do it justice so bad. So RoboCop, when we go down, comedian Dave Landau has a show on the Blaze that we do, and it's in Dallas at the old Paramount lot, and they filmed Walker, Texas Ranger, Barney, and, you know, the most notable film would be the first RoboCop. And the guy playing RoboCop was like, I'm going to be in character at all times for this. So he's like, I am RoboCop. And he was at Craft Services. And he's like, I am, you know, like RoboCop. And he's and he was next to the dude that was on that 70s show, The Dad.
The bad guy Red in the or whatever. Film. Yeah.
And he's like, doing that shit. And he's like, cut that shit out. I can't even do it justice. Like, I'm calling Dave. Do you have Dave's number in your phone?
You want me to try calling him?
Yeah.
Do you have your phone?
I don't know.
He'll answer for you.
Because he's got to do it, because the way, like, his response is key. Like, that's the punch. That's what's funny. And I haven't thought about that or told that story in a while. And I just, justice has to be done to it.
This is exciting because you just tried calling me for.
I know. That's
a cute picture of Dave on there.
Yeah.
You should see my photo for him.
Yeah, he's got flowers in his hair. Better answer. Wait, what time is it? What day is it?
He's not on. I have his profile contact on my phone is him dressed up like Brian Stelter as the devil. He's going to a concert tonight, actually.
Oh, is he at a concert?
Yeah, he's gonna see Stevie Wonder.
Oh no, but I remember what it was. So,
and I also think you should leave all that in there. Don't cut that out.
Yeah, yeah. So I remember what it is. So he's like, I am RoboCop. Like, I will take rice and fajita steak, you know. And that guy from that 70s show looked at him and goes, f*** you. That's what he said to him. So then he never did it again. He just stopped right there.
Yeah, you need that.
Yeah,
that's how it should be. I don't know. It's weird. And people say like method acting will cut years from your life, which I think is a little bit dramatic. Like, I've heard actors be like, if the scene, you know, calls for you to cry, just fake it. Don't actually cry because you will cut years from your life if you do that. And it's like, dude, come on.
Well, you know, like
there's people who are like digging trenches for a living to put fiber lines in there, you know?
So, I mean, my theory on a lot of method acting is, and you know, this is my opinion and I don't have anything to like back up this theory, but it just seems to me that a lot of the people that are method actors are either like drug addicts, alcoholics, very erratic behavior, very unprofessional behavior.
Yeah.
And it's almost like an excuse that they can use to like take a bunch of drugs in film or drink a lot or just be complete douchebags like Jared Leto. And it's like their cover. Like, I'm a method actor. It's like, no, you're just doing a copious amount of drugs.
Yeah.
And when people are wondering why you're acting that way because you're so trashed, you can just be, people are like, oh, he's like that because he's a method actor.
Yeah. Yeah.
I feel like that's probably what Heath Ledger was doing during The Dark Knight.
Oh,
like where people are like,
Randy said that even, yeah. That,
yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, we had this conversation with Randy.
Yeah, he's like, you're not acting, you're just like, hi.
Yeah, yeah.
So
exactly, and he's of the, and he, I mean, he was in American History X, tons of TV shows, very accomplished, very talented actor, and he just thinks it's all BS. And he's like, no, man, you're an actor. It's acting. So when they say action, you just pull whatever emotions that you need from your toolbox of emotions that you've experienced in life,
yeah,
and then you put that into it and you act, and then they say cut, and then you're done.
Yeah.
You don't have to mail, you know, dead rats to your co-stars like Jared Leto and,
yeah,
and laugh all the time and act like a complete psychopath.
Yeah. So one of the things that brought us together as friends and stuff was wanting to make movies. And we wanted to make movies that were honestly good. We wanted to, you know, put our faith in it a little bit as Christians. And that's kind of what got us together. And so I had been, you know, I had written a script and was trying to figure out how do I get it made. So I kind of dove into the to the film world, you know, in Nebraska, and I found out that there was more there than I expected. And so this is what I was saying, we should just have this conversation on camera because it might be interesting, but like I think that I figured out how to do it. I've talked to you about it before, but when people try to make movies locally for a low budget, what a lot of them will do is be like, they focus first on the acting, and they'll be like, my friend Teddy is a really good actor and he's really funny, so like, you know, he's going to be the main character, and they spend all their time looking on talent. Well, I think that what you should focus on are all the people behind the camera, and try to get, and not just get like, oh, my friend who knows about lighting, he'll do it. Like, no, get somebody who's in film school or fresh out of film school, who's a professional, and get as many professionals as you can. And so what I've done is I've met film students from around the state, you know, people who have graduated or are still in school. And these are people that are going to, when they graduate, they're going into the industry. Some of them will move from Nebraska to LA. There's kids that went from UNL and they were in the Barbie movie, not in it, but they worked behind the scenes. Like, these are professionals. So if you can stack a pro crew, it's going to look good visually. And then from there, I believe that you have to have the right genre, or you have to have the right script to go with it. So if you want to make a movie locally and it's going to take place in outer space, good luck with that. You know, it could be, anything can be done.
Which, even if you have the budget, is just a terrible decision because space is stupid.
But so you have to have the right script. You have to have the right storyline. And you have to have a path to get it made. You have to even know, like, how to write specific scenes that you can do locally. And so I've written a few scripts with the mindset of, like, how can I make this so if it can be a movie shot on basically nothing but still be an interesting story. And I think that the number one genre that makes this super easy is obviously horror. And I think one of the hardest ones to do is comedy. Now, when we shot Secret Driven, the reason why we could make that work was because it was us and a camera, and we made it a mockumentary. So anything that was bad with it, you know, even if it was not even intentional on our end, can be written off as this is a mockumentary because the character is setting the camera up himself. But if we're going to make something else, it has to be a
higher quality. It was more them, like, yeah, yeah, just like documenting their experiment.
Yeah.
Or experience with just, you know, just run-of-the-mill camera.
So now everything is forgivable. If you don't do it right, basically what it feels like is you're watching an hour and a half to 2 hour long YouTube video. Nobody wants to watch that. So horror is the
easiest
one. But
the sound has to be great. Like, you can...
Sound and the visual. And the lighting, like, that's the other thing,
yeah,
is, like, lighting is so huge. And one of the best example I can give for this is those Terrifier movies. The first one that they put together was, like, a collection of short stories. Then the first, like, Terrifier movie that they had made, they basically had, like, professionals who could do the cosmetics and the gore and all of that stuff and make it look good. The acting wasn't, it didn't really matter. You know what I mean? What mattered was the gore for them in that case. And they were able to turn that into then their next movie, I think it was their next movie, was like a $10 million budget. Yeah, Terrifier 2. there's really like four of them out, because there's the short film one, then the low budget one, and then I think the second one had a budget of maybe like $10 million, and then they have Terrify 3, which is in theaters right now, which had a huge budget, which
I read that like sent people into like cardiac arrest and they were vomiting.
I think that all that is marketing. It's just like with Paranormal Activity when that came out, people were like, women were dying in the theater of heart attacks.
I'll tell you the one, just the true experience that I had with just something like that, where people freaking out about watching the movie, was Blair Witch Project.
Oh,
because I was in high school when that came out, and they marketed that entire movie as if it were real. And then they shot it like it was. And I mean, I remember it didn't come out, you know, till shortly after the film was released, you know, maybe even longer. Like it could have been 6 months, a year. I mean, I don't remember exactly. It was a long time ago.
Yeah.
But they're like, no, this, you know, it was like an actual movie and they set it up, but
fake website and everything.
Yeah. But the way that they did it, it was all like, this is, you know, like footage that we have acquired. And
the beginning of the marketing campaign all started with the website blairwitch.com. It was published in the summer of 1998. And up until about a year or two ago, you could still visit it in all of its HTML glory. On the site was a full timeline of events starting in 1785 when the witch was banished into the woods, and ending in 1997 when the footage was found and turned over to the families of the filmmakers. If you were visiting the site in 1999, it really made you feel like this was real. They had some pretty convincing photos, and they kept adding stuff as if new information was being found in real time. And that became the overall strategy for the rest of the campaign, to make this entire story feel real.
And that scared a lot of people.
Yeah, they thought it was real. I mean, anything based on a true story seems way more scary. So,
and I even remember like seeing ads in magazines and stuff, like full page ads about it, and like, we found the footage.
Yeah,
the witches,
and the actors had to sign like contracts, where basically they had to lay low and like hide. And great acting too, by the way. Like that girl, like when they're screaming at each other, and I think snot's like running from their. I mean, I actually watched that movie, I think, last year, and it is pretty crazy how good of a job they did. And it's significantly less scary once you know it's not real, you know. But yeah, at the time, that was crazy. So I think that horror is an easy genre to do on a low budget. And so I had written that script that was my first book, just a fictional novel about sleep paralysis. And my mindset being was that, well, you know, most of the film will be in the dark, so your costumes don't even have to be that much, don't have to cost that much, because if it's in the dark, you're not really going to see the details of it. You know what I mean? You're just going to see the outline of the costume is what's going to be more important. And so that's what I think would be easy. Now, I'd written an action movie, which you said that that's the one that you really want to do more than anything. Same type of a deal. Like when I wrote it, I had each location in mind, a location that I knew we could get, or I was, you know, positive that we could get, with people in mind, most of them not being actors, but who I know could play the character. You know what I mean? And then relying on the people that I've met and have done films with who I know are good actors and who I know will be around and be able to do it. So what I was telling you about earlier, though, what I think may be the move is for us to make three short films, make an action film, make kind of a romantic drama type film, and then make another kind of a uplifting drama type film, and shoot these as a trilogy and get them out there. And we can do multiple things with that. For one, we'll sit down with the crew who I know are professional, and whether they are just consulting with us on how to do it, or if we get them as crew for these films, what we can do is record this. You want to direct. And so that's going to give us experience doing all of these things. We have to make it as close to a legit looking movie as we possibly can. Put these out in the film show circuit. Now, the benefit to the film circuit isn't as much for the actors as much as it is for the directors. That's where a lot of directors get picked up. That's where they can get a budget for their movies, whatever. I don't ever hold hope that like somebody's ever going to find me. That's never been my mindset. You know, you have to go find the people. And so while there is that benefit of, hey, maybe, you know, we'll come across something in the film circuit and that would be good for us as well, it also gives us a body of work that we can pitch to investors even locally. And what I would like to do
let's not mention it'll be fun.
And what was that?
And it will be fun.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously, yeah, it's a passion thing. You know, it's definitely going to be fun. And I'm surprised at how much I do love acting. Like David Gunn had asked me about that before. Like, do you like it? And I said, dude, I think I like it. I think I might like it more than I like doing music, which I never thought I would like anything more than playing music live. That'd be like you. Well, not quite. I mean, you've been doing it for like 20 years, but like that would almost be like you saying you like acting more than comedy. You know what I mean? Like that's had your heart for so long that, you know what I mean? It'd be different to find something like that, that you're like, wow, I really enjoy this, but I really love it. And so, yeah, obviously there's that as well. But then that gives us a body of work that we could pitch. Cause man, I would love to make a movie for legit anywhere from $1,000 to $20,000 and be able to say, if you donate this money, if you give us this money, we're going to be able to flip it and make more. And doing the same thing that Robert Rodriguez talks about in that book, Rebel Without a Crew, that was his whole thing was like, I'm going to make this one and I'll make like $10,000. Then I'm going to make a second one and then I'll have $30,000. Then by my third movie, I'll have enough to make the, you know, the one that I actually want to make or whatever. Well, he got, you could call it lucky, but he thankfully or whatever for his sake, found people right away who were like, oh, cool. Like, you know what you're doing. You should make Desperado, I think was his second movie. Yeah. But by that point he was like 19 and already had like 10 years of experience because he was so hyper-focused on filmmaking when he was a child.
You know? Yeah. Yeah. And, no, I love that style of movie making to this day where you're not relying on special effects for action, but you're actually using squibs, you know?
Yeah.
And, blood packs. But yeah, after reading that book, then that inspired me to write like a sketch that, I did with, Adam Devine, my buddy. I mean, this was like, we were 22 and him and then Kyle Newacek, who is now, directing Happy Gilmore too. So super shout out to you, yeah. Kyle, cause that is the coolest thing ever, man. So awesome that, you know, me and him are the same age and we've known each other since we were 19.
Weren't your apartments like across from each other?
Across the road. Yeah.
Yeah, dude, that's crazy.
And then, but yeah, we would talk about movies all the time and just knowing how much like Billy Madison and Happy Gilmore and Waterboy and all that had influence and how much we love those movies. And then, you know, flash forward all these years later and he landed being able to direct Happy Gilmore too. I'm just like, dude, that is incredible. But I wrote this sketch just because I wanted to use blood squibs. So it's like drug-free America. And we're all, you know, me, Adam, and then our buddy Kyle, not Kyle Newacek, different Kyle, are in a garage and we're smoking weed and then we pull out a gun and we're playing and we're just shooting each other for fun, you know, because we're high and it makes you crazy. And I bought a fertilizer, like something that you, like one of those, not like fertilizer, but weed spray containers where you mix your own and then you pump it up
and then
you have a tube and you can spray it. So we did that, made fake blood, you know, then we had a tube that went from that and we would run it up to where it was. And then I made like little slits like where they were going to get shot. And then, you know, they'd shoot it. And then I put a trigger on it. And then Kyle Newacek is directing it. He hits it. And then it's like, boom, you know, like the blood like just sprays out. So we're just in my garage, you know, like the day before I get married, just splattering blood everywhere.
Is that film anywhere?
Yeah. I'm gonna put it in it.
Oh,
put
that, this in it. Yeah. Yeah, you definitely should. That'd be cool. Yeah.
Drug-free America.
Went to Colorado with my baseball team. All we did was smoke bowls. It's done, man. It's done. I am putting it out.
Dude, look at that value of it.
Good, man. I know, man. That's crazy.
Yeah, man. That's good.
Austin would have still been alive if we hadn't been smoking weed. Smoking weed impairs your judgment. And if you smoke marijuana, your friends will die. And you'll support terrorism. And you'll forget to shower. And you'll get bad grades in school. And your dad will hit you with a belt. That is, if you're still alive. Brought to you by a partnership for a drug-free America.
Yeah, I never heard about that one. That's amazing, but
because it's just not the same, man. You watch movies now, and they just, you know, the CGI. I get it. It's way easier, but you know, the CGI, the gunfire, and then the blood, but just like 80s action movies into the 90s, where we're talking about like Rambo, Commando, all that, where they're just using squibs. It's just
squibs.
It's,
also hurt, I've heard.
It's so much cooler though. Like the fact that's, those are the kind of movies that I just really like, where like the set pieces are like, they actually have to blow up a helicopter.
Oh yeah.
They actually have to have explosions going off everywhere to symbolize like, you know, rockets exploding.
Yeah.
Or grenades or something like that. And it's like, that is just the way more just realistic and way cooler way to do action.
Yeah, I think so too. I think a squib is, it basically feels like you're lighting a firework off on your chest.
Yeah, and I've never used like a real one or anything like that. Just creative ways to make my own.
That is a really that is a funny way to do it. No, and I think the other thing too is like, so if you're staying out of the actors union, you're making everything far more cheaper. And so again, my theory is, because you can actually be a crew member in Hollywood. I don't really know how that works on the crew side, but I know people who have worked on big movies who were crew, and they never were in the union, and they didn't want to be in the union. So I don't really know how that works, but from the crew side. But if you can do that, you get crew members, you get it to look like a movie, you get people who can act good enough, or where their acting doesn't even matter. I think that you can make something significant. So I think we do the three short films. Mark my words, we'll see if we do it. Do the three short films. It's gonna take a few months to do it. We do that, and then from there, that's going to give us the confidence to do the movie. Because if you remember with that action script, we were like, all right, let's film it. And we wanted to film that last year. And then you and I were basically both like, what do we do though? Like, yeah. We didn't know. Like, so, and I've got a little bit of a better idea, you know, now, but still, it would be good to do this ourselves, get that experience, and then go from there. And then, like I said, you stay out of the union side of it. That's going to save you a significant amount of money, because as Randy told us in that one interview, you know, there's all sorts of rules of what you can and can't do. And once you're SAG, I mean, you're really locked in on that. And so by staying out of SAG, and it's interesting that you had the opportunity to go SAG and you never did.
Yeah, I didn't, because you know, I had called actually Kyle.
Yeah.
And Adam, and I was like, hey, should I join SAG? And they're like, no, just like, if you're going to live out here in Hollywood, yes. But if you're going to stay in Nebraska, then no. You know, and they gave me the reasons why. And they were right, because then a bunch of stuff that I've done after that, I probably wouldn't have been able to do.
Yeah.
Like being in independent films and stuff like that, or certain videos. And
you know, when I started auditioning for stuff, for commercials, for short films, for movies, I had like a streak where I got every part that I went out for. And then the one that I didn't was for a SAG project. And while I was kind of disappointed, because I was like, oh man, if I would have got that, I would have been in SAG. I am happy now looking back that I didn't, because I would have joined the union, not knowing that, you know, 2 years later that I would want to be doing something where I don't want to be, you know, in the union. And so, that's one of those things where you're blessed for what you didn't get.
Yeah, I got to look it up too real quick. So like, I didn't even, the only reason why then after I talked to them, I was considering it, and it cost, you know, this is like the mid 2010 to
12, probably.
Yeah, or 16, something like that. And it costs like $2,500 to join. And then I'm like, all right, but the one reason why I wanted to join is, and I got to look it up so I get it right.
Don't you get like health insurance if you do it?
Yeah, there's like health insurance through it, but that wasn't like the coolest perk. I'm going to find out what it is.
Yeah. So that's the idea. That'll give us a body of work besides, because Seeker Driven is like, obviously we're proud of it and stuff, but that's not really like something that you can be like, oh, I know how to make a movie because I made this mockumentary. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like that's, and I wouldn't even feel confident with it. One thing I have learned in life by watching other people is like, you can bullshit your way into a job or a position, but if you don't know how to actually do it, you're going to wish that you never did, you know?
Yeah. So I think it's you get a vote for one of the, is there SAG AFRA awards?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was the coolest part about it. Like if you're a member, then you get screeners of like all the movies that are going to be up for the SAG movie awards.
Yeah.
And you get a vote on it.
Yeah.
So I was like, that would have been the coolest thing. That,
yeah.
Dude, to be a part of it.
By the way, I've heard that Gladiator 2 is amazing, and that people are saying that Denzel Washington is going to get all the Oscars and all the awards.
What role does he play in that?
I don't even know. You know, all I've seen is the trailer, and obviously it looks good. I'll say this too, and tell me if you agree, and tell me if you watch this in the chat on YouTube, tell me if you agree. I think 2024 has been one of the best years of movies in a while, actually.
Dude, I would agree with that, man. I don't watch a lot of new movies. Like, my way to really just, like, you know, when I've been working a lot and just having a lot going on, like, how I would like to just, like, unwind and kind of reset was going to the movie theater and watching a movie. And I haven't seen a movie in the movie theater like that in a very, very long time. Like, I've taken my son to a couple, you know, like the Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Across the Spider-Verse, and then the one with the other guy.
Ninja
where,
Turtles.
Like,
Ninja Turtles.
Yeah, the Ninja Turtle one. And then the Spider-Man where they go back in time and Tobey Maguire shows up and all that.
Oh, you're talking, because you saw the cartoon and the live action one, I know.
Yeah, so those are the ones, but as for like going by myself, being able to have like 2 hours where, you know, I can just escape and get drawn into a story, there's nothing out there. So I'm very excited to see Gladiator in the theater. And then, but the movies that I have seen that I was super impressed with, I really liked Twisters.
Yes.
And you were the one that told me to see it.
Yep.
And I was like, yeah, dude, that was a good movie. But I really like, when I was just in Dallas this last week on my flight home, I check American Airlines, you know, on your deal, they'll give you free internet, but you have an option of movies you can watch. And that was The Fall Guy.
Yes.
Not to be mistaken with The Free Guy. you know, starring actors both named Ryan. But dude, the Fall Guy, I was like, man, this is just a legitimately just good movie. And the humor in it was just so subtle. And yeah. Ryan Gosling, I just think, delivered his lines. Like, you know, his humorous lines just perfectly, nonchalantly. And yeah, I just thought it was all around awesome.
Yeah, I know people who are super conservative Christians who are very, very careful about what they watch, and they loved it. And when my wife and I watched it, we loved it too. And it's like, yeah, it's like, oh, wow, that was a really good movie, you know?
So, right, because we don't need, like, there, like, we get it. If there are two love interests in a movie, like, you can hint at them finally, like, hooking up by, you know, them, like, staring into each other's eyes and then, like, walking towards each other and going in for a kiss. And it's like, oh, we get it.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They just had sex. Like, we don't need to see, like, a 5-minute sex scene.
Yeah, dude, some of these TV shows.
Where I'm just like, you're just like, why?
Yeah, like, some of these TV shows I've seen that have come out in the last, like, year or so where they're just, like, having like hardcore sex in the show, and it's like, okay, didn't really need to see that.
Yeah, but it's just like with the plot, you know, it's like that famous rule that you can read in some screenwriting books where it's like, all right, at this mark, you got to show some boobs, you know, at this mark, you know, is when you have a twist, at this mark, yeah, you do this,
yeah,
to keep people engaged.
And dude, I
know a perfect example of that is the first Die Hard, where he's, you know, on the plane or whatever, he gets in the taxi, he gets to the party. It's fairly early on, 15 minutes on. He opens the wrong door looking for his wife's office.
Forgot about that.
And it's just like a guy and a girl with their boobs out doing lines of coke.
Yeah.
And it was just like, boobs.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's just like, for some reason, they believe that we need that in order to care about a movie.
I bet we're from the same household, which I think a lot of people are from, which is like your parents didn't want you to watch any movies with boobs, but you could watch all the movies you wanted to that had extreme violence.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I mean, I kind of get it. Like, I heard when I worked at a cable company, there was a guy there who was like, well, I don't care about nudity. Like, I let my kids watch it because, you know, I think that there's violence is more of a problem in the world than people having sex is.
I love it. Like, when I was growing up and Rambo 3 came out, and I was in elementary school, possibly sixth grade, but more likely, elementary school. And, the neighbor who was a year younger than me, you know, who we were friends with our entire childhood, his dad actually like bought the analog editing equipment that I actually ended up purchasing when I was in high school, where it's basically you're editing from one VHS player to another, and then you can do cuts or you can cut out audio and then put in audio. Yeah. Well, he did that to Rambo 3. So all of a sudden you'd be watching it, and when they were gonna be like, you son of a bitch, all of a sudden it would just like the audio would cut out, and it would be his dad going, you son of a gun. the whole movie, dude.
Dude, when I was a kid, I will never forget this. I loved, for all I know, I've even told the story on the podcast before, but I loved Roadhouse, but I'd only watched it with my dad when it was on TV, so I didn't know that there was any nudity and stuff. And I always like begged my dad to like record it or something on VHS so I could watch it whenever, and he never did. So I was at the store with my mom, and I see it on DVD, and so I'm like, Mom, can I get this? And so she buys me Roadhouse. So, I'm watching it at home. I have no idea that there's nudity in this movie. And right as my dad comes home, he's walking into my room, just like all the memes. I'm like all excited. I'm like, Dad, look at what Mom bought me. She got me Roadhouse. He walks in, and it's that scene where that guy's having sex with that girl in the closet, you know? My dad walks in my room right as that pops up. So, dude, my dad goes and tells my mom, and he totally made it sound like I was just watching that part of the movie as if I'm, like, rewinding it or
something.
Yeah, yeah. So my mom flips out, comes in, like, rips the DVD out, throws it
just
away.
Just scratches it with the key.
Oh, yeah, and then she's like, your dad said that he was going to make a copy of that movie for you. And I'm like, well, dude, this has been going on for, like, a year. You never did. And then I remember, like, months later, I brought up the movie. Like I quoted it, and my mom's like, I don't want to hear anything about that stupid movie.
Oh, dude, it's because she got in trouble.
No, I got in trouble.
No, but your dad got, or no, she got in trouble by your dad, probably.
Everybody got, I think everybody got in trouble.
It was a black stain from the Beckel family.
Yeah, everybody got in trouble for that one. You know, by the way, too, one thing I would say is Chuck Norris. So many actors have gone through the dilemma of what we're doing, where it's like you want to make a movie and you know that you're not going to get the shot if you just wait for someone to give it to you. Obviously, the Stallone story with Rocky, everybody knows that. But what I was really, intrigued by and inspired by was Chuck Norris, how when he made The Good Guys Wear Black, he basically got some investors. And when they said, how are you going to do it? He's like, I'm going to go around the country and I'm going to get all the martial arts schools to watch this movie. So for his like first few movies, he would go and do karate demonstrations, break some boards, whatever, and get schools to go watch his movies. And that's how he would fund them.
Well, yeah, that's interesting. Like how John Hughes built up such a following for his films in the 80s. Pretty in Pink, 16 Candles, Breakfast Club, is he actually had a fan club that people could join and they would pay money and then they would get special perks. Like he would mail them stuff out. He would answer, questions and memorabilia. And that's kind of how he made sure that people were going to see his films. But going back to like where you got to have boobs in it.
Yeah.
It just reminds me like Steven Seagal was just notorious for it. Like, yeah. I don't know about his like later catalog when he became obese and
probably
was
got
making
worse, to be honest.
Movies with DMX and stuff. But but like one example, like Under Siege, the chick from Baywatch, just he's walking around looking for Tommy Lee Jones and Gary Busey to do some of this.
Yes.
And he kicks the cake and she just jumps out and is like,
yeah, yeah, true.
You know, like it didn't even, that did not need to be in there. And then
on Deadly Ground, he has that native chick. She gets naked for it.
Okay. Yeah. So
Fire Down Below doesn't have any nudity in it.
Oh, yeah.
Which is why my dad let me watch that when I was like 4 years old.
And, but one thing interesting that I had read about The Breakfast Club is that the studio was given, John Hughes a bunch of notes and stuff like that. And he was essentially like, that's all filmed at a high school in the suburbs of Chicago. And you can actually, like, he speaks on it, I believe, in an interview or possibly an article, but about how he thought that he was going to have to fund it himself and do it as a movie that he really wanted to make. And he was like, all right, I'm going to write this as one location. And then he actually said it made it the hardest thing ever. And so it was the hardest deal. But one of the notes is the, just like a scene in it where they walk in to the swimming pool area at school, or it was the principal. And there was a girl that was, she was swimming and she was swimming topless.
Yeah.
And they wanted the shot to be like underwater looking up at her boobs in the water. And then John Hughes was like, no, no tits.
Yeah. It's funny when you told me that too, because when I wrote the sleep paralysis script, I wrote it to mostly take place in one house. And then you told me that he said that was like a bigger pain in the ass. And I was like, oh, but I don't know why, though. I'm not sure why that would make it a bigger problem.
You know, he elaborated on it and did explain it. I don't remember that part of it.
I'm really curious to know why.
It just had something to do with setting up, like all the shots. So it wasn't a built set.
Yeah.
You know, they're shooting in the school.
Yeah.
And just being able to maneuver in setting up different angles. In different shots.
Yeah. No, that's interesting. But I mean, in you, I mean, I'm asking this genuinely, like on camera and everything, but like, you're down with that idea, right? Of the short films and everything.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I didn't realize that you were that interested in directing and stuff. So are you more interested in that than acting?
Yeah. I am not. I never wanted to be an actor. I have done acting and would do it again, but it was never like, I want to do this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It mainly because, I guess I just don't have a passion for playing other characters. I just like being myself.
Yeah.
But I mean, I've been, shooting video and editing since I was 17.
Yeah.
And so it's just, that's just the aspect that I like about it.
Yeah.
Setting up the shots, getting the shots, like putting everything together and making it awesome is just the passion.
And I think for me, why I like to act is obviously I'm a curious mind, as that's why I have a lot of books. And I think what every time you have a character, it gives you a unique opportunity to do a ton of research into, you know, whatever that character is. So when I first would like ask for short films, I would just say, I don't need to be the main character. I want to be the most interesting character. And that's what I tried to pursue, whether it's short film or whatever, and trying to dive into whatever that mindset is, I thought would be fun. And one thing I've realized, because I was reading that book Range, which is the first book that made me actually feel good about myself, because it explained how a lot of people who are top performers, they don't actually just focus on the one thing, like the Tiger Woods and as people like him are kind of the exception. Like most Nobel Prize winners, most of them play classical music or do other things as well. But I'd always felt weird about it because I love to make music. I love to write. I love to act. And I realized like really what it is I think that I like is just telling stories.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And yeah. You have a lot of passions and you want to pursue those and do them all. I get that. I mean, I'm the same way. Like
yeah.
I have, you know, so many different things that I enjoy doing, like photography, videography, video editing, stand up, writing, like all that. And yeah, I remember I was having a conversation with this guy and he was just like, diversity is for pussies. Like you just got to focus on one thing and master that. Like if you want to succeed. Now, possibly that could be true, but also I cannot live a life like that.
No.
Like I have to.
Do you think that guy's like, happy?
Oh yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Like, and I think it just depends on the way that an individual's mind is wired.
Yeah.
Where it's like, all right, I got to hone in if, you know, I'm going to do this one project. Well, you kind of did that like with writing the book and we all do, but his was more of like, you know, just staying in that lane, like picking a lane and then staying in it. And it's like, I cannot like mentally, emotionally, physically, or whatever, like do that because I have so many interests and I want to try so many different things and do so many different things that's what makes life exciting for me.
Yeah. And I would say from the time I was in high school to my, you know, maybe mid to late 20s, I was, you know, music was the biggest thing that I focused on and studied. And I was talking to the bassist in my band once and we were just talking a lot about it because I was saying, you know, I was bummed out that it didn't pan out we got to do some cool things, but it wasn't what I thought it would be or what I had hoped it would be. And I just had this realization that like, look, there's other things that I want to do. And once I started to figure out how I could do them, I just wanted to do it. You know, I thought, well, if I ever want to write a book or if I ever want to make a film, I have to have a ton of money or I have to have something. And once I started to figure out, and honestly, the music, what was nice with that is like you learn the DIY thing and I take that with me, you know, into these other realms. And so I did focus on one thing for a long time.
Yeah, because you do, like you have to, I mean, that's the only way that you learn. That's the only way that you can learn how to do it. It's like, learning how to do stand-up. Yeah, that's all I focused on. Got on stage wherever I could doing that because that's the only way that you can get good at it.
Yeah.
But, you know, I guess kind of the way that I operate in you too. It's like, all right, you focus on that one particular thing, you grind it out, you complete it, and then you go on to like the next thing that you're interested in, or the next thing you want to learn how to do, yeah, or master, and then you set in on that.
Yeah. And I think for me, once I zoomed out and I realized that it wasn't just the music. What I loved about music was the storytelling aspects of it, that each song was a different story. And then I zoomed out and I realized, like, relatively recently, within the last few months, I realized, like, no, it wasn't just the one. If I zoom out, what it is it's the storytelling. That's really where, like, the passion has always been, the storytelling in a song, in a book, in a film. And, you know, with this year, you know, taking off most of the year to focus on one project and setting the podcast aside, setting a lot of other things to the side, painfully too, you know, but
yeah, you want to do it all. And and the reason why we can't is because we're both married. We both have families.
Yeah.
So we have, you know, that huge responsibility,
yeah,
of it. So it's not like I'm going to write a book and I'm also going to make a short film and do a podcast all at the same time while providing for my family, because
they don't call it
starving artist for no reason.
Yeah, I thought that that's what I was going to do too. I really thought that I was going to do everything at once. And as I got deeper with the book, I realized, like, dude, there's no way. Like, it's not for me to do this book justice. And honestly, it was something that I wanted to do for Rosenbach, and he's told it to me, and I think he would tell anybody. He said, if it wasn't for you, this book would never have gotten out. He said, I couldn't have done it. And for me, it never was about money or anything like that. The experience of it was nice, but for me, it was the honor and the respect to give him, because I grew up doing martial arts, and I truly believe that having that baseline of martial arts as a kid always gave me the confidence to, it just gave me confidence overall, I would say. And that's pretty much everybody's experience who gets involved in any form of martial arts. Once you start doing, whether it's the discipline or the self-defense aspects of it, it gives you a confidence that you can carry yourself with. And with that confidence, I was able to do a lot of cool things. And so for me, this was something that I could give back to him and leave this book, so that way, you know, he's in his 70s and, you know, he's had heart surgeries and all these different surgeries. And it's like, look, he gets to tell his amazing life story in this book. We're going to put it out there, and that's going to last forever. And so for me, I wanted to do it. Now, again, I wanted to do these short films. I want to do all these other film projects. I wanted to do, desperately want to do the podcast. Like, it drives me nuts when people say, I ask, are you in Austin? Like, are you guys still homies or whatever? And it's like, yeah, dude, Austin and I talk every day. But it's me who's saying, like, I have to wait because I wanted to, you know, get this book done, and I wanted to do it right. And so now that, you know, it's October, and you know that we got it done, now I gave myself literally basically a week to relax, and now it's like, okay, this is what I want to do. And for me, this stuff is like relaxing. Like, this is something that, like, I spend all the time that I can with my kids, and then once they go to bed, I'm either doing one of two things. I'm either spending time with my wife, or I'm working on these projects that I'm passionate about. And like, that's just how I'm wired at this point. Like, I am not somebody who can just sit still. And you know, I love to, when I can dial in on a project, like, I love it. When I would do short films, I would spend my own money on like props, and I would go so far above and beyond. And like, I talked to these like film students, and be like, this is my approach to the character, and like going in on it. And like, you could see they're like, all right, cool, man. Like, yeah, like, you're kind of a side character, but like, go for it. Or when I did the Western, like, I'd spent so much time like doing gun tricks, like spinning the gun or whatever, and it didn't even make it when it came time to shoot, I had this coat, so I couldn't, like, I had mastered like how to spin the gun into the holster, but I couldn't do it because I was wearing a coat. But like, again, that all builds into that. Like, I just, that's what I love to do.
Yeah. And so, yeah, and that's what you wanted to learn it. And if anything, it was just an excuse so you could learn it.
Absolutely.
For yourself, you know. And yeah, that's the thing, is like, if you want to start something or get good at it, like, whatever it is, and we'll just talk about art specifically here, if you want to do stand-up or you want to make films or you want to be a writer, it's like, you just got to know that you can't get into it just being like, oh man, I'm going to, you know, within a year, I'm going to be making money and like,
yeah,
this is going to be my career. It's more, it taught me like doing stand-up is like, yeah, dude, you got to like put in the work and do it for free for a while.
Yeah. Way longer than you would
than you think. Yeah. It takes a long time, but it's like, so if it's something that you really, really want to do and someone wants to hire you or you have an opportunity, but it's not the, like a significant amount of money or like no money, but like, if you want to do it, you have to do that.
Yeah.